both sides.
Way better than Bill Sanders.
Way, way better.
All your life is a
this is a guy that owns 20% stock in Tesla.
I wish I could.
Well,
why don't you get that side?
Okay, I'll get over you. I can do that.
If you get in?
Oh, yeah. We got it.
And there's a CD player. All the controls are right over your head. Oh.
You couldn't wait to see what I was going to have for breakfast. I hope you get one of these one day, LaDuke. I'll learn how to run a camera just for you.
And there's more where that came from.
And there's more where that came from. Boy, is there a lot more.
Yeah.
All of your favorable opinions, and I don't want to lose any of your gratitude. I will try to make this short, but it is difficult to make a speech about Gordie Little short. There's so much to cover. That's not a joke, by the way. I don't really know. I'm trying to figure out this morning why I was asked to be the speaker this morning. And it's important if you're going to speak to an audience, they always instructed me, understand your audience, understand what your job is, and understand how to do that. The hard part is the latter, but if you don't understand the first two, you're not going to do a good job. So I'm thinking, why me? Clearly, I don't love Gordie as much as Kay does. No one can. I don't know Gordie as well as Mike Mannix does and many of the others. I don't talk to Gordie as much as Clyde Rabideau does. But here I am just the same, because no one in Clinton County is a bigger fan. I listen to Gordie in the morning. I listen to Gordie whenever he's on the air. And you know, Gordie, how often I call you up on a Sunday morning because my son has a paper route, so I was up very early. Of course, he was always up before us. I'd like to just free associate for a minute, because I think that's a way to cover a whole lot of ground without a lot of words. Floods, fires, people in need, like April LaValle, Roger Senecal years and years ago. Pancake breakfasts. Now, I want to say at this point, the Morrisonville Fire Department really should name a truck after Gordie. Because I am absolutely confident that at least one, and maybe more, of their pieces of apparatus was bought and paid for entirely on the fact that Gordie sold pancakes. And as we were talking earlier, when you're on the radio, when you're in the media, you can sell a whole lot of whatever for your friends, for your clients, for Morrisonville Volunteer Fire Department, simply by talking about it. But now I might get on the radio or some of the rest of us and say, oh, by the way, there's a pancake breakfast out of Morrisonville, starts at 7, goes through 12, and now back to the music. Not Gordie. By the time you got through listening to Gordie talk about the pancakes and the syrup dripping off of the ice, I'm not going to go on. You've all heard it. You were out the door. Maybe you hadn't even shaved, but boy, you were going to get some of those pancakes. And that is the essence of salesmanship, the essence of what Gordie does, did, and always will do. Strange phenomenon in the sky, another thing I wanted to free associate. If anybody in Clinton County or within the range of Wiry's signal saw or heard anything weird, boy, the radio audience knew it in a few minutes. And why not? Because everybody's interested in those things, and if you've got a radio station that lets you know right away that somebody called in from Peasleyville and saw a flying saucer over Terry Mountain, well, you might have a chance to get out there and see it yourself. You think I'm kidding, Scott? I mean, that's what radio's all about. Radio is instant. And if you don't take advantage of that characteristic of the medium, you're missing the boat. Now, every radio station, every news medium has its tipsters, people who call in. They call in the news, the events, the strange phenomenon in the sky. They call in anything that's on their mind. Every radio station has its tipsters, but Gordie made the people who called in part of the airwaves. Now, most radio personalities learn at a very early age that the more you can tell people, the more they think you know. Okay? And if you're on the radio day in and day out, day after day, and you tell people things they don't know, they're going to naturally think that you're the smartest person in the world. And if you're clever, you realize that you never, ever want to tell anybody who told you that. Because that, of course, would take the shine off the impression that you're the one who knows it all, right? Kind of like the Wizard of Oz. Everybody thinks you know everything, and never, 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 so the rule goes, draw the curtain aside and let the people see how and where you find this all out. Because then, of course, your image will deflate, and you'll be just seen as an ordinary human being, not the Wizard of Oz. But Gordie did it differently, to his credit and to the everlasting gratitude of his audience. Gordie made himself bigger than life in a different way, by opening the curtain and letting the audience know all of the people who called in by name, where they were calling from, what they had to say. Not always, some people wanted to remain anonymous, but for the most part, rather than taking a call from me or you or whatever and using that information to make himself look smart, he told everybody who it was, and he made himself the center of a very big family. And it really was, it was different, it was better. And it was Gordie. Sometimes Gordie would put that right on the air. Sometimes he'd get off the phone, not wait for the next newscast. As soon as the record was over, tell the story right away. Again, immediate. If you didn't do that, it would be old news by the time you got it on. And don't underestimate the long-term gain for Gordie, too, as people learn that they too could call Wiry. You know, if Mrs. Smith was on Wiry, well, why couldn't I be? And of course, the more people had called, the better the program was, the more information it disseminated. I remember one time driving to Albany on a, actually it was a beautiful day in Plattsburgh, but at Warrensburg, there was black ice and blowing snow. And after I got narrowly through avoiding a 10-car pileup right there on the hill at the top before you go down into Lake George, my first thought was somehow to warn people back home who might be coming down the road as well, leaving under a bright blue sky and hitting that black ice, perhaps to their peril. So I picked up the cell phone and called 563-1340. And before any time at all, I was talking to Gordie, passing on the warning. But I was, in my mind, I was just doing my good deed for the day. There was nothing more to it than this is something that a person ought to do to warn his friends, and Wiry is the way to do it, and Gordie was right there to pass it on. So I put that behind me and kept on my way. Well, I thought the story was over, but 20 minutes later, the cell phone rings again. And it was Joel Stashenko of the Associated Press in Albany. We understand you're right in the middle of some bad accidents, Assemblyman. How do you know that? Well, of course I should have known. Gordie had called the story into AP, and they thought it was pretty novel. This was, of course, in the days before everyone had a cell phone. And in papers all over the state the next day, people read about the Assemblyman on his cell phone calling in weather reports from the Northwest. Of course, I didn't call Gordie every day, only when there was something important or something interesting or something that I knew, because I was a listener, that the Wiry audience, Gordie's audience, would want to know. Other people were regular, touching base every day. You know, it's sometimes important to remember, and sometimes hard to remember for those of us who are very busy, working all day, getting around the county. People like Jim King people like myself, people like most of you in the room. It's hard to remember sometimes that there are fellow citizens, neighbors of ours, who don't even get out of their houses, never have a visitor, hardly get an email. And for them, the voice on the radio is even more important than it is for us. Of course, Gordie knew that, and he heard from them. And as I said, you cultivate people calling in, people will call in. And a lot of those folks were regulars, and he knew who they all were. They didn't have to even identify themselves. He knew who they were from the voice. We didn't even always know who they were, but just the fact that the guy on the radio recognized the voice calling in, sometimes no name was even exchanged, but you got the point. They knew each other and you felt like you were part of the family too. Magic, absolutely magic. Absolutely magic. And as speaking now briefly as a political candidate, or sometimes political candidate, that's the place you want to be if you're in politics too. Any place that the audience is where you want to be. Hopefully doing something that doesn't embarrass yourself, but that's where you want to be. Now, seriously, anybody who doesn't understand that doesn't understand American democracy. And I want to just say something kind of pedantic, but I really mean it, and I think it's something worth thinking about. Gordie Little, doing what I've just described, which we all know because we listened as well, made his radio program fit into the whole scheme of things in exactly the way the Colonial Tavern did. You know, a lot of business got done in the Colonial Tavern. Sometimes historians have remarked that if it hadn't been for that meeting place, where all the leaders and all the citizens of the community, or at least the men in those days, those were different times, gathered on a regular basis and talked about things, and if you were running for president, as George Washington was, he said at one point that his campaign had actually been very expensive because he had been required to buy liquor in rather substantial quantities at every tavern in every town he stopped. And if you calculate that with inflation and everything, it's actually more expensive in his time than it is today, thanks to modern media. But Gordie made his program in this little town, in this little part of the world, the equivalent of that Colonial Tavern. And frankly, as one who is involved on a daily basis in public service, as many of the rest of us are, if we didn't have that, if our citizens didn't have that way for us to communicate with them and them to communicate with us, we'd be a poorer place for it. And I want to thank you for that. You set the stage and you've done something. Well, let me put it this way. A former colleague who shall and should remain nameless never understood Wiry and Gordie Little. He asked me once, why would anybody listen to Wiry? And I mean, I knew where he was coming from. It wasn't slick, it wasn't overproduced, it didn't even have an identifiable music format except on Sunday mornings, and so why would anybody listen to it? Well, I don't think you had to ask the question, and I told him that. If you have to ask the question, nothing I can tell you will answer it for you. You just have to think a little bit more, because it was and is the essence of community. It's not the program. It's not the medium. It's not the packaging. It's the people. And the best medium of all is one that you never see, if you understand what I mean. You know, you get a letter in the mail, and it's from your mother, and she's telling you what happens at home, and you forget that it's a piece of paper with writing on it. You don't see the medium, you see the message. You see the person, you see your family. The best medium is one you don't see. It's not overproduced. It doesn't call attention to itself, it calls attention to the people. And Gordie, your programs always did, and your life always will. Now, in the final analysis, as Pat Paulson would have said, analysis is just what we need. But Gordie was good at what he did on the radio, just as he's good at everything he does and everything he will do. For one simple reason, and you don't need to analyze it to death. If you really like people and you care about them, you will do whatever it takes to serve them and serve them well. Whether you're a waitress in a diner in the middle of the night who could just as easily be rude to her customers, or whether you're a fireman up on a ladder getting a cat out of a tree when you know darn well it'll come down on its own eventually, but there's a little girl there who's crying and she needs you to bring it down now, or whether you're Gordie Little on the radio doing everything you can think of to help people know everything they can about their community. And the proof, ladies and gentlemen, is in the doing, not in the caring itself, because anyone can say they care. But you know who really cares by those who actually do it, go the extra mile. And Gordie, for all the years you worked so hard to inform, educate, inspire, entertain, and bring us together, we're here today to salute you. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris.
Good morning again and welcome. No better here.
Congratulations.
Oh, are they beautiful? Love
Dave. Gordie, how are you doing?
Talk to you. Gordie.
Yes.
How are you doing?
You're Helen.
Good.
Yes.
Good. Hi, Gordie.
Thank Bobby, my man, how are you doing?
Are they beautiful?
Oh, my God. What a change, huh?
This is beautiful. This is just for you.
No, I'm on.
Hi, Gordie.
Oh.
How are you doing?
Yes.
Good to see you.
Good to see you, too.
Well, I invite you all to go out on the lakeside. We don't need to look at the parking lot side. Gordie, you have a wonderful day today to celebrate. So let's go over on the...
Technology building out in back here that we are also building. It's a conversion of an old building that was here, and that will be also that will be a big building.
Patience to make it.
You probably are dragging a trailer behind you.
No, I'm carrying all these.
Oh, you're carrying all this.
I sure hope they don't end up and hit my trunk. Oh, gee, that'd be awful.
Why don't you slip off that jacket, if you would?
Okay, here we go.
Let's try a Clinton jacket on.
The shirt and the pants, too, Gordie.
Yeah. It's a warm day.
Good, I needed this speech. I got to work on this for you, Gordie, this speech. I'll be working in the front seat.
Oh, look at this.
Okay. And then we have to have
you... I really stick the belly out now.
Completely attired here.
Oh, look at this.
There you go. And?
Oh, I'm hit.
Smile, Gordie.
Good, I better teach you this fall.
This
is great. Wow.
Faye, we'd like you to have a couple of coffee mugs if you would take these with you
beautiful.
And enjoy them.
Thank you very much, and we will.
And we do.
Load those up with coffee.
Every day.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
We want to,
see my mug?
Thank you this day for all that you've done, not only for the community, but all your support of this college as you have... day in and day out supported us in our mission, and we really appreciate that over all these years. And you're continuing to work with us in the foundation, which we appreciate, and the foundation leadership is here to make a presentation. So go ahead, folks.
Oh my goodness.
It should be me.
Christmas in June.
Gordie, you can't wear this.
Let
me get over here. You really can't wear this, but we had a student here, an alumnus of the college, who did a sketch a number of years ago on the defense of Plattsburgh, and it depicted the events that took place between September 6th and September 11th in 1814. And that sketch was later turned into a print, and the artist has signed a limited number of these prints. And we thought, since you're such a history buff, that it would be nice to add this to your collection. And it is a signed limited edition print of the defense of Plattsburgh, and it goes to you with our very best wishes, and we appreciate everything you've done and will continue to do for the college and the foundation. Thank you.
Michael, thank you so much. Wow, that's so cool.
Did a good job.
Way better than I could do. If you could see the presents I wrapped, no comment over there. Thank you. What a place. This is it right here. This is where the X should be. Right on this patio. Every time I stand here, I'm transported back to when the trolley tracks came out here, and all the highfalutin big city society spent their summers here. Unbelievable. Just a wonderful place. A great past and a great future.
Right.
Yep. Thank you so much. You guys are cool. What a day.
Fine. What are we up to today?
It's a very little appreciation day.
Right. In the trunk.
I took the limo right up to the airport one time.
How did you just think it was
like a half an hour before the drive? You walk out and he said, we helped him search for half an hour. He was on the wrong floor. We looked for every car in Dorval and finally found the limo. Oh, the poor guy was
desperate.
Gordie, on behalf of the Plattsburgh Fire Department, we'd like to present you with this honorary chief.
Oh, man! Okay, we got it now, baby.
For all that you've done for us through the years, I know this is just a small appreciation, but I just want to know we care about you.
Thank you so much.
Wish you the best in all your endeavors.
I'm going to call Jim this afternoon and tell him he's out of a job. Thank you so much, my friend.
And we miss you on the radio.
Oh, thanks. I'll just stand in my yard every morning and talk real loud, give the weather forecast. It's great. What a day, huh?
This is an
amazing, wonderful day. You see Bob? I knew Bobby before he came here. He was a dispatcher. We used to come down here and
I'm crying. close to. I'm crying.
And I was already traveling in that road, and there was somewhat of a dirt at that time. But I went beyond Pizzaville. I went up at the disco, and Uncle Phil was my father-in-law. And the two of them were the only relatives that John like to stretch all the way from the back shed to the front porch. But I just wanted you to know that I traveled that road long before you got there.
For the many times that you have helped us to help protect the people of Clinton County. We've gone through many disasters, such as, well, the great blizzards of the 80s, the floods that we had last year, 1996, were events that had never happened in this county.
A lot of help from Gordie Little. He was on the radio constantly, making people aware of where bridges were closed and roads were out. And more importantly, he was genuinely concerned for the safety and well-being of those people. And we're constantly asking them to call him, and he would call us if they needed help. So Gordie, it is a distinct honor of mine to tell you that we are now in the process, and we've never done this before, and it takes a little time for this paperwork to become reality. We're in the process of making you a Clinton County firefighter. That's a firefighter from each department in this county. I don't have the paperwork with me today, but shortly, thank you.
What that really means is you have to go to every fire in Clinton County.
Maybe one day last fall, when I told him that our goal for the Christmas Bureau for 1996 was going to be $40,000, I think for one second he was at a loss for words.
People are absolutely amazing. I thank you so much for coming out on this beautiful, sunshiny day. You know what? This is incredible. I got a good friend here in Clinton County. Every time he talks to me on the telephone and every time he sends me a note, he says, "Remember, Gordie, every day's a holiday." Well, for the day at least, Gerd Keener was right. This day has been the most amazing holiday for me. And you, all of you here, and the many who aren't here, are the ones that make it that way. There is magic in Clinton County. And if we can figure out how to bottle it, or even write it down and get that message to people who live outside of Clinton County, we'd never have to worry about tourism ever again. It would take me very long to find out what Clinton County is made of. You know, it's made of good stuff. That's what it's made of. My father, rest his soul, many years ago told me, "You do something good for somebody, it'll come back to you tenfold."